brought to you by Penguin.
Fibber in the Heat, written and read by Miles Jupp. Chapter 1. I love cricket, but I can still remember a time very clearly when I didn't. I was ambivalent about cricket. It was just another sport, like all the other sports that I also felt ambivalent about. I must have first played it when I was about 6 or 7 at school. I had a copy of the tabletop game Test Match, which featured Ian Botham and David Gower on its box. I played the real game, albeit badly, for my school under-10s team. I even, for a time, went to afternoon nets in the indoor school at Lord's. All the time, however, I was just going along with it. It was part of the timetable, like football or athletics. It was just one of those many things that you did at that age simply because you had to. But one day, all of that changed. One fateful morning during the summer holidays in 1991, bored back from boarding school and looking for something to do, I pushed open the study door of my father, a former church minister. He now had a mysterious academic career writing about death. "Come in," he called, without registering that I hadn't actually knocked. His study was a long, narrow room with steep, crammed bookcases on each side. The shelves were piled high with the academic tomes that provided the bibliography and footnotes to his work. A number of tall, grey filing cabinets were arranged haphazardly about the place, giving the room a feeling not unlike a carelessly thrown-together sculpture garden. Each one had been placed exactly where they stood by a delivery man. "Just put it down where you like," my father had told the first delivery man. "I haven't decided quite where to put it yet." He would then give the cabinet not another moment's thought until a day came when he realised that it was full and so ordered a second one to be delivered, whereupon the pattern repeated itself. I dodged my way in and out of the metallic standing stones and made my way to the far end of the room where my father's desk was placed, under a huge window through which bright sun was streaming down onto the many piles of notepads, newspaper cuttings and files that covered most of the desk. Only a small proportion of the desk seemed to have been set aside for working on, but in the summer months that position was usually coveted by a large tabby cat who liked to sprawl and bask, eyes shut, for as much of the day as possible. "I've just stopped working to have a cup of something for elevenses," said my father, who then immediately began to reorganise a pile of files on the floor by the desk. I sighed. I wasn't really sure what the work was that my father claimed to have just stopped doing. All I knew for sure was that it involved lots of paper and lots of books, and that when we went on family holidays we seemed to spend a lot of time visiting cemeteries. I knew what my mother did for a living. She worked in London in order, she said, to finance whatever it was that Daddy did. But the truth was that I wasn't remotely curious about what my father did all day in his study. I wasn't very curious about anything. This made it all the more surprising to my father when I suddenly posed him a question. "Daddy," I said, "what's happening in the cricket at the moment?" To this day, I have no idea where the question came from. I lingered over the words "the" and "cricket" as if I was repeating a phrase that I had heard somebody else use and wanted to make sure that I was pronouncing the phrase correctly. Of course, I'd talked occasionally about cricket in the past, but never before would I have dreamt of referring to it as the cricket, as if it was a region of Africa that people had suddenly started mentioning because there was a civil war there. My father was both delighted and stunned. It was probably the first question that he had heard me utter all holiday, other than endlessly saying, "What can I do to stop me being so bored?" "Well," he said, breaking off from attempting to decipher some handwritten notes he had once made on an index card, "at the moment England are playing a test series against the West Indies. There's one game in the series remaining, which starts in a week's time, and if England win it, they will draw the series." And that was that. In a single moment of intimate paternal connection, I became obsessed. There was something so beautifully clear about this equation. So much of what my father usually tried to explain to me was well beyond my comprehension, but here I had been furnished with an answer the essence of which I could grasp immediately. My interest in cricket went from almost nothing to an obsession in an instant, lurching into action in the same way that a sleepy dog might when it hears a key turning slowly in a lock. My father passed me a copy of that day's Times, still warm from another cat, this time a large ginger one who had been sleeping on it. I sat down on the floor of my father's study and read all of the cricket reports and articles in it. I then went to the pile of back issues that teetered on a creaking chair in the kitchen and wormed my way through all of them, ignoring the headlines on the front pages that must have been concerned with unrest in the Gulf, and instead turned to one of the back pages where I could read about bowlers in good rhythm or batsmen struggling to convert their county form into test runs. Cricket, I soon realised, had its own language, and it was one with which I instantly fell in love. Outside of articles on cricket, one could never conceive of people being described as wristy, or happen upon a sentence that read, Although proving adept at playing inside out, he was less sure sweeping against the turning ball and eventually perished as he top-edged to a leg gully that had been moved finer. The fact that at first I didn't understand a single word of it did nothing to dampen my newfound fervour. As well as its language, I also found great pleasure in analysing the statistics that were carefully laid out in each day's edition. I realised that if I attacked the last week's papers in order and spread them all out on the kitchen table, I could follow the course of each county game day by day. Each game was a self-contained story. I would read the preview that was printed on the morning of a game's start, and then monitor the scorecards and reports that appeared in the next 4 days' editions, thus feeling that I myself was involved in each game's ebb and flow. In some games, one side would dominate throughout. In other games, the initiative would be seized and re-seized in unexpected, brilliant moments, and thus the balance of power would swing back and forth wildly like a lunatic on the end of a rope. I spent entire days just doing this. I tried to share some of my new knowledge with my older brother Edmund, who liked to spend all his waking hours reading novels and listening to music. Several times I bounded up the stairs to his room at the top of the house armed with some bits of newspaper that I thought contained interesting tales, but he could never really demonstrate any interest in what I was telling him. He would merely wait until I had finished my prepared speech and then say, "Call me Ed." He had, in fairness, just commenced the messy business of being a teenager, and so who knows what sort of thing was going on inside that body or head of his. Instead, I would report my observations to my father, who would say things like, "Yes, cricket can be like chess sometimes." I thought that cricket seemed nothing whatsoever like chess. Whenever had a chess player been praised for being strong off his legs? Alongside such insane utterances, my father was also able to impart more practical advice. This included showing me how to use the teletext service on the television so that I could check for cricket news and scores throughout each day. It was through this medium that I eventually learnt that England's squad for the last test of our series against the West Indies had been announced. I recognised many of the names from the county scores that I'd been reading in the Times. G. Gooch and H. Morris played for Essex and Glamorgan, I knew, and M. Atherton played for Lancashire. A man called A. Stewart had been recalled, whom I knew to be a Surrey player. Another player had also been recalled with a name far more recognisable than all the other names put together. I. T. Botham. In the event, I was unable to watch any of the match's coverage on television. My father, as had long been agreed, had taken my brother and me away on a holiday to Ireland. My mother, though too busy to commit to any substantial time away herself, felt that the three of us would benefit from a camping trip. People that knew us thought that camping seemed a strange thing to attempt by a family that hadn't ever really managed to master simple domestic life. We were, after all, a family that sometimes sat down together for supper when my mother had returned exhausted from London, only to discover that none of us had actually thought to prepare anything to eat. Thus we'd sit around the dinner table discussing our respective days and eating nothing but cheese and tinned fish. We were all very excited about the idea of camping, though, and had gone and rented an enormous tent as well as a portable cooking stove and gas canisters. But being excited about the idea of something and actually having any aptitude for it are very different things. In the end, of the 18 nights that we spent away from home, a mere 6 were spent sleeping in the tent that had been hired for this purpose. We had a terribly depressing experience in a place called Spittle that was so wet and gloomy that my brother and I decided that camping was not for us. Privately, I suspect my father had realised very early on in the holiday that we were simply not up to its demands. All that I really liked about this way of life, it turned out, was starting fires, an activity that was forbidden at most campsites. On one disastrous evening, I was stung on the ankle by a wasp, and in a state of confused shock, all that I was capable of doing was jumping up and down while shouting, "My head, my head," which meant that the source of my panic took far longer for my father to uncover than it should have done. Ed, meanwhile, had a habit of letting his mind wander at crucial points during our frequently fraught attempts to put up the tent. Just as my father was saying something along the lines of, "Now we all need to pull at the same time," he'd realised that Ed had let go of his end and was instead practising chords on an imaginary guitar. "The rest of us are trying to put a tent up, Ed. What are you doing?" my father would ask through gritted teeth. Ed, once shaken from his reverie, would always calmly reply, "I am awaiting further instruction." My father began to find this ritual rather tiresome, although he could never admit to this, and so he told us that he didn't like camping for an altogether different reason. He told us that he was appalled by how much it had changed since he was a Boy Scout, and was horrified by how prissy it had become. If you were going to stay in something called a campsite that actually had electricity, gas hobs and working lavatories, then you might as well be staying in a bed and breakfast. And so we did. Much of our time away was spent travelling to what the guidebooks described as places of interest. We kissed the Stone of Eloquence at Blarney Castle in Cork, and climbed the stairs of Tor Ballyleagh, where the poet Yeats had lived. In Dublin, we visited the house in Upper Dorset Street where Sean O'Casey had been born, and late one afternoon we clambered over the rocks of Sandy Cove.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.